When it comes to learning something new or making any sort of change, one of the biggest enemies of those things is feeling uncomfortable.
Go ahead.
Sometimes it's small. I had a question, I felt weird, but I didn't ask it. Sometimes it's bigger. I wanted to apply for this job or this position or this promotion or this school, but that uncertainty made me feel weird and then I talked myself out of trying. We all have things in life that we want to do, could do, should do. And more times than not, the reason we don't is because we feel weird. We feel uncomfortable. So the question is, how do we change this? How do we fix this? So I found an awesome researcher from Harvard Business School. Her name's Alison Wood-Brooks. And she actually created a survey that asked a bunch of people that very question. You and I were going to do this survey together right now. So she goes, imagine at your workplace, you were presented a big challenge. This challenge freaks you out, it stresses you out, makes you nervous. The question she asks, what's the best advice to give yourself or someone else in that moment? When they collect and categorize all the responses to that question, they found that over 90% of people say something like, calm down, don't worry, don't be afraid. And there's all sorts of ways of like sending those signals or sending those messages, but by far and away, the most common response, over 90% of the responses say something like, calm down, don't be afraid, don't worry, it's no big deal, be fearless. Everyone here has heard those things before. Everyone here has said those things before. However, what we're gonna go through for the next few minutes is the research that shows that is exactly the wrong approach. As far as topics that I've learned about learning, this is the one that's helped me the most, and it's not even close. What the actual science says about getting better at dealing with stress, fear, and discomfort.
When we seek to answer our questions by observation and research and experimentation, we are using the scientific method.
The first study that I want to dig into that shows the science-backed, more effective strategy to deal with tough emotions was conducted by Jeremy Jamieson.
So we were looking at students who were preparing for this, maybe it's a stressful occurrence where you're taking a standardized test that has a lot of importance for whether you're going to get into different grad schools or not. And we brought them to the lab to do sort of a practice test.
Students at Harvard were divided into two groups. Group one was the control group. So they got no special training or instructions. They deliver them the math section of the practice GRE and essentially say, here you go, complete this exam. Group one scores a 684 out of 800. The second group is the intervention group. They received the same exact exam that group one got, but on top is one paragraph of instructions teaching them to what Jeremy calls reappraise the stress. Reappraise the stress is kind of a fancy way of saying, change how you think about the discomfort.
Which really telling people that, like, yeah, you're gonna be, it's stressful. I'm trying to pretend that like this test isn't stressful, it's stressful. You're going to be highly aroused. You're going to be sort of like your heart's going to be beating fast. Your palms going to be sweaty, but that's fine. And so it's more of like, that's actually good. It's not like this is bad. It's not something avoided. This is good. If you were disengaged and you didn't care, that'd be bad.
So this paragraph didn't tell them like, don't be nervous, but it also didn't say it's fun to be nervous. In a nutshell, it gave the students permission to be nervous, permission to feel. Group two scores a 739. That's a decent bump in performance coming from one paragraph. 1 month later, all of these students, they take the real GRE.
And so then we have them take the GRE test in the real world. So they go off, they take the real test, and then they come back and they gave us their ETS, their score reports. And they did better on the quantitative section, on like the real GRE test. So it wasn't just like this lab situation where it helped outcome in some isolated setting, it kind of generalized.
This was one study, one day, one paragraph. No further contact with the students. But a month later, the students that read that paragraph do better than the control group.
It's really understanding a lot of the way we respond emotionally, affectively, stress responses. These aren't like isolated boxes. And so if you can teach people and give them the tools to adapt, more adaptively respond in one stressful situation, they can kind of take that with them and apply it to other situations. you're changing people, the way they're engaging with their world.
So Jeremy Jamieson's study really looked at the benefits of changing the way we think about discomfort when it comes to taking an exam. Ali Crum out of Stanford conducted more of a field study where they looked at real people in the workplace. They divide the employees into two groups. In each group, they watch a series of like 3-minute videos over the course of a week. So group one, they receive sort of traditional messaging videos around stress and discomfort, talking about all the downsides of stress. Group two watches a series of videos that's more aligned with this reappraisal idea that talks about the benefits of stress, why we feel stress, and how it can help us in different situations. Then they track the employees for a while and they measure all sorts of stuff. First, Ali Crum and her research team created what they call a stress mindset measure. It's a simple survey that can measure sort of our perceptions towards stress. Group two, the intervention group, their stress mindset actually improved over the course of the study. Then they looked at health and work performance. It ends up, group two, the intervention group, they see improvements with their health and better performance in the workplace, all coming from watching just a few videos about changing their mindset towards stress. Maybe the most surprising but important result of this experiment, though, there was no significant change in the amount of stress between group one and two. There was no reduction in stress. So the increased work performance and better health was not a byproduct of them eliminating the stress from their lives. No, those benefits were a byproduct of changing their mindset towards the stress itself. The final experiment that I want to dig into is one of my favorites. So Alison Wood-Brooks, she conducted this experiment at Harvard Business School. She picks three things that create a lot of discomfort that usually freak people out: public speaking, math test, singing. So just like the other experiments, they divide the students into groups, and then they receive special instructions before their task. Group one is given instructions that really encourages them to frame the stress as a negative thing. They're told stuff like, calm down, you're nervous, relax. We're gonna call this the suppression group. Group two is given instructions that helps them reappraise and reframe the stress to see it as more of a helpful thing. In each three of the activities, public speaking, math test, singing, group two outperforms the suppression group. I love the way that they conducted the singing portion of the experiment. So you go into like a small room and there's a couple people sitting at a table that you don't know. They have a Nintendo Wii hooked to a TV. And you stand in front of the people and you have to sing "Don't Stop Believing" to them. Just thinking about that makes me feel weird. So group one, who receives instructions beforehand that really paints the stress as a negative thing, they score a 53% on the song. Group two, the reappraisal group, the one that's given instructions that changes their mindset and interpretation of the discomfort, that paints it as more of a useful thing, a helpful thing, they score an 81%. That's a huge boost in performance coming from a small shift in the way they talk about the stress. When they do experiments like this, they can measure all sorts of stuff. They're measuring heart rate, blood pressure, hormones. In this experiment, they even gave students a simple survey that measured their levels of anxiety before doing the task. And what they found in not only this experiment, but many, many more, there's no significant difference between the groups. Everybody's heart rate goes up when they're singing "Don't Stop Believing." Everyone's blood pressure rises when they're taking the math exam. Everyone reports similar levels of anxiety, which means on paper, group one and two are kind of feeling the same. And that is one of the most important points for this entire topic. The truth about tough emotions, we actually don't have much control over exactly how we feel in every moment of our life. Of course we can regulate emotions, but they are not light switches that you just turn on and turn off. Hey, stop being nervous. Okay, boom. That's not how it works. We take the power back from our tough emotions, not by fighting and suppressing and denying them. We take the power back through understanding and accepting. Put yourself into the shoes of group one, the suppression group. You're told things like calm down, don't worry, relax, but then you're taking the math exam, you're singing Don't Stop Believing, you're doing the public speaking task, you're probably going to be feeling during those things. Your instructions are, don't feel, but then you are feeling. How are they going to interpret the discomfort? Well, most likely is a negative thing. I shouldn't feel like this, but I do, which means I'm doing something wrong or something's wrong with me. Where is their attention when they're performing the task? On the stress. Why am I feeling this? How do I make it stop?
Like, it's, I mean, you hear, you ask 100 people on the street, 92 of them will say stress is bad. And so the only reason the sort of stress reappraisal stuff works is because people don't think stress is useful. And so what they try to do is they try to like ignore it. They try to like get rid of it. They sort of like pay attention to the stress rather than pay attention to doing what they need to do.
But then compare that to group two, who's in the same room, singing the same song, taking the same exam, and feeling the same as group one. But because they were given permission to feel, they can turn their attention to the task at hand and not fighting this losing battle of stop being nervous.
There's this wonderful effect in psychology, and the effect is called amplification. The more you try not to think about it, the greater its hold on you. So we know when people push aside difficult emotions, that kind of internal pain doesn't just go away. It tends to actually come back and it tends to become suffocating.
If we think that we always need to be fearless and calm and free of nerves, when we do feel those things, we assume we are doing something wrong or there's something wrong with us.
Human beings are stressed all the time. People have stress responses many times throughout the day in different forms and flavors. And if you believe that stress is always bad for you, it means that there are going to be many moments throughout the day where you think, what's wrong with me? What's wrong with my life? Why am I feeling this in my body? Why can't I handle this? It creates this first an internal state of like, I can't. I don't want, I'm not enough.
We've all been there before. I can remember before I knew about this research, I'd get really nervous before my presentations. I'd be backstage and I'd experience like the nerves of I'm about to speak to a group. But almost every single time, I would slip into this spiral of stressing about the stress. Uh-oh, I'm nervous. That's a sign of weakness. I must not have practiced enough. I'm too young to do this. I'm not smart enough to do this. Imposter syndrome to the max. And you see where it's coming from. This traditional mindset and approach towards stress and discomfort exaggerates the original emotion. We feel bad that we feel bad. We're freaking out that we're freaking out. And it's all coming from this flawed assumption that we shouldn't be nervous, that we shouldn't be uncomfortable. Like I said earlier, this topic has helped me more than I could ever explain. Since learning about this research, I've given hundreds of presentations to groups from all over the world. Lots of practice, lots of reps. But if I'm being 100% honest with you, I still get nervous every single time. But now I have a better mindset towards those nerves. I know that I feel weird before giving a presentation because I really, really care how it goes, and we don't know exactly how it's gonna go. A simple formula that I hope you never forget. Caring plus uncertainty equals discomfort. Every time. So yeah, with that framework, with that equation, it's really straightforward to see how to never be uncomfortable in life. Simply don't care about things and don't do things that involve uncertainty. You're gonna feel great. But if the goal is to grow, to learn, to connect, to lead, to be a great parent, friend, teammate, we have to do things that involve uncertainty. And we're probably gonna care about those things, which means we're going to feel.
Life is stressful. People who have meaningful lives experience a lot of stress, in part because stress is often a signal of meaning. It's a sign that you care, and this is a moment that matters. And so the goal is not to avoid stress, and I will probably not be able to construct a life for myself that is low stress and also high in the things I care about, like people, and learning, and contribution, and adventure, or whatever it is.
If you want to get better at getting better, making this mindset shift around the way we think and talk about fear, stress, and discomfort might just be the most important thing you can do.
The context changes, our lives change, and we change.
And so it's only when we open to the difficult emotions that come as part and parcel with being human that we are able to then adapt to that change. You know, at its heart, that is what learning is. And that is what being agile and adaptable is.
Keep in mind that nobody is perfect with this. And we're also not asking you to like go home tonight, pick the thing that freaks you out the most and do it tomorrow. No, treat this as a skill. And just like any skill, we can start small and get little reps. Maybe it starts out with, I have a question, I feel weird, but I ask it anyways. Research shows as we get those reps of feeling, doing, we can get better at this over time. And when we face fear and discomfort in one scenario, it can help us in other situations that typically cause those tough emotions. We are not saying that it's fun to be nervous or fun to be afraid. Of course it's not. All we're saying is it's human and normal, that the presence of stress and discomfort doesn't mean we're on the wrong path, and it doesn't mean we're doing something wrong, especially when it comes to learning. Our goal here is not to become fearless. We just don't want fear making our decisions when we're trying to learn. And we do that not by removing the fear, but by changing our mindset towards it.
Ever since the world began, men have been scared. The brave knights of old had those same cold beads of perspiration. Their hair stood on end. Their hands got clammy. Their hearts pounded. But it all makes sense. Nerve cells get hopped up. You see more clearly. You hear more keenly. Your heart pumps faster, and you breathe harder, bringing in more oxygen to change that sugar into strength. And here we are. Scared? Yes, but ready. That's the best thing about fear. You can make it work for you instead of against you.